Hey everybody, and welcome to another tutorial on expectancy theory. This one is for organizational behavior, and I entitled this one Motivating Our People. We can use this theory in a bunch of different contexts, but most importantly, we can use it at work. And I want to go through this short theory with you from organizational behavior. It's called expectancy theory. So let's get started. So expectancy theory is all about motivation and how we begin motivating our people to do different things. And the motivation aspect really falls around four different inputs. One is needs, the other one is effort, we have performance, and then we have valence. And I'll explain those as we go through them. But really, this theory is all about emphasizing the needs of organizations to relate rewards directly to the performance and to ensure that the rewards provided are those rewards deserved and wanted by the recipients. And that's key, not only deserved, because that's fair and that's just, but are they wanted by the recipients? And so when we run into expectancy theory, we come into this short little concept of E leads to P. So E is short for effort, P is short for performance. And there's this idea that we have a certain amount of effort that we put into an activity, and we expect, that's why it's called expectancy theory, we expect a certain level of performance to come out of that effort. And so when we're looking at motivating employees, one of the things that we can really key in on is elevating their performance. And there's two things that we can keep in mind when we're looking at elevating our constituents' performance. The first one is improve their ability. And we can do that through training, we can do that through skill training or skill building, we can do that through external webinars or internal lunch and learns or anything like that. Anything that builds their skill is building their ability. So skill coupled with the effort raises the performance level. We can also look at increasing their confidence or increasing their self-efficacy, the belief that they can actually do something outside of what they're normally used to. And so when we begin to build their confidence, it has this feedback loop mechanism into the process. And so that begins to raise the level of performance without necessarily raising the level of effort. And that's key. The other piece with expectancy theory that we need to think through is this idea that performance leads to an outcome. Now, an outcome, we could also substitute the word goal here. And so the goal is something that we set, and whatever method of goal setting that we're using, it really doesn't matter right now, but we have this goal or we have a desired outcome. And so the effort leads to a performance level, and that performance level leads to an outcome. And so to make sure that we're motivating our employees well enough, there's a couple things we need to keep in mind when it comes to outcomes. One, we need to measure them accurately. How well do we know that the outcome is matching the performance level? How well do we know that the outcome is not only matching performance level, but is in direct relationship to the effort put forth? So how can we measure the outcomes? The other thing we need to keep in mind is higher rewards are reserved for those who are top performers. And this makes sense to us, that those who perform better tend to get better rewards. And so that outcome is directly related to the effort through the performance. So it makes sense that we can expect, hence expectancy theory, that if more effort is put forth, there will be a higher level of performance. And if there's a higher level of performance, thus will be a higher or better outcome. And so when we look at outcomes, there's this term valences or valence. And that really reflects the idea of feeling in association with the outcome, meaning we have a certain amount of effort that we put forth and it produces a performance or creates a performance level, and that performance level in turn creates an outcome, and then there will be a positive or a negative feeling associated with that outcome. And that's why they're called valences. And so when we look at specific outcomes that are favorable or outcomes that have been achieved either quicker or better or more efficiently, we have a positive valence, or we have a positive feeling. And on the flip side of that, conversely, if there's a certain amount of effort and a performance level is reached and an outcome is achieved, but it's less than desirable, and see, you're going to have an outcome either way, whether it's a desirable outcome or a less than desirable outcome, you'll still have one. And so that's sometimes why we stay away from the word goal, because have we achieved our goal or not? Well, that can be subjective, but whatever we do, there's an outcome. There's data there that we can look at. And so there's a feeling associated with that outcome or that goal. So if we have a certain amount of effort and it creates a performance level that produces an outcome that's less than desirable, then our constituents are going to feel more negatively about that outcome. And so it really comes into fruition, or comes to a point for us, that we want to begin asking our constituents, what do you want? If we're going to start matching the rewards to performance and effort, we need to begin asking the question, what do you want? If our constituents want a more positive outcome, okay, then we need to start reverse engineering or looking at different ways to motivate our people to achieve that outcome. And so higher rewards for top performers is an example of this. So we would ask our constituents, what do you want? Well, I want a higher reward if I achieve level X. Okay, so to achieve level X, you're going to need to perform at this kind of level. And in order to perform at this kind of level, you're going to need to put forth this kind of effort. Okay, so you can see how we reverse engineer our way back from the outcome through the performance to the effort. Because we know that in some cases, people put forth a lot of effort, it's going to produce a performance level. And whether that performance level is high enough or not, it's going to produce an outcome. And that's where people become satisfied or dissatisfied. And that in turn, again, has a loop back effect on motivation. And if people are achieving their goals and they're feeling satisfied about that achievement and the reward that they're getting is valuable to them, they're going to have a positive sense of feeling about that, and that's going to feed into their efforts. They may increase their efforts a bit more. They may begin to become more efficient in the application of that effort to hone and refine the performance level, and in turn, increase the outcome or achieve a higher goal with that outcome. So we build into this reward the idea of, what do you want? Now, Maslow was one of a couple different social scientists who came up with this idea of needs. And so when we're asking somebody in our teams or in our organization, what do you want? What we're really looking at doing is getting at, what do they really need? And so Maslow spent considerable time putting together this theory where people have this base physiological need before anything else. And so we look at food, we look at water, we look at shelter, we look at clothing, even sleep. All of these things are very basic and fundamental to us. And if we are in deficiency in those, it's harder for us to begin thinking of higher level needs or meeting those higher level needs, like those of love and belonging, or those of esteem, or those of self-actualization. Because Maslow was proponing that if we're not taking care of physiological needs, as well as safety needs, we can't begin to think about meeting the needs of belonging and love and esteem in the higher ones. So if somebody's physiological needs are being met, but they're still not feeling safe, like their personal security is threatened, they feel like their employment is shaky, they're making it day by day, week by week, paycheck by paycheck, or even they can't buy a home, they can't get into any kind of security in that regard, they're going to have a hard time putting any effort and cognitive effort towards this idea of esteem and self-actualization. So Maslow came up with this hierarchy of needs, very popular. The other one that I wanted to talk to you about is McClellan's motivational needs. And I kind of lean to this one more than I lean to Maslow's, because it speaks to three basic needs that every human has. One is the need for achievement. We all have this drive in us to achieve certain things. Some of us have the drive more than others, but we all have this need to achieve. We all have a need for affiliation, or we all have a need to belong to something. And then thirdly, we all have a need for power, and whether we want to use that power for good or for evil, we all have this need for power, because through power, we are enabled to enact change. And so I take these two theories and I kind of boil them down to its essence. And for me, when I look at motivating, whether it's a team or whether it's my family or even it's myself, I have two basic needs. And I really believe that everybody has two basic needs. One is a need for value. They need to feel valued. And that can look like an achievement, where they place a certain amount of value on achieving something, like a degree or a level at work, a position or prestige. Or we have a need for power. We want to enact some kind of change. And so we look for the strength and the power to enact that change. Okay. And so when we come to this idea of motivation, we need to begin asking our constituents, what do you want? And when we ask that question, we're really digging into the idea of needs. And so whenever I talk to a team, I really ask them three basic questions. What do you want to do? Where do you want to go? And who do you want to be? Because if I start getting answers to those questions, I can start boiling down their basic needs and begin to understand whether it's a need of value. Do they have a need to belong? Do they have a need to be affiliated with a certain group? Do they have a need to be liked by a certain person or a group of people? Or are they looking for power to change, to make change, to enact some kind of educational change, some kind of social change, some kind of economic change? Are they looking for power to leverage that? And for me, in my experience and in my reading and studying, I've boiled it down to really two, this need for value, need for power. And so answering these three questions, who do you want to be? Where do you want to go? What do you want to do? Helps me get to those answers. And then I can begin reverse engineering my way back so I can better help my constituents understand, okay, you want to achieve this goal? That's a very important goal. Lofty goal, timely, relevant. Are you excited about it? Yeah, all of those things, great. This is the level of performance that's going to be needed to achieve that goal. And then looking at that level of performance, we begin examining the effort level. Do you have the work ethic? Do you have the discipline? Do you have the willpower? Do you have the skills? Do you have the knowledge to put all that together to achieve the performance level? If not, we'll shore you up. We'll build those strengths in you so that when you do put forth the effort, you can achieve that performance level, achieve that goal, and feel really good about what you've done through the whole process, because we know that that feeds back into this thing called motivation. Hope that helps. Take care.